So let's get started in the interest of time. Well, before we get to the main attraction of today, which will be Luca Olmi's talk, I just want to share some piece of news if you haven't heard. Last week, in commemoration of the a year anniversary of the collapse of the telescope, bills were introduced in the U.S. House of Representatives and U.S. Senate. These bills are bipartisan bills, you know, support from both parties. In fact, the bill in the House was introduced by Jennifer Gonzalez, representative, Republican representative from Puerto Rico, and was endorsed at the time of the introduction by Congress people from both parties. And in the Senate, it was introduced by Senator Blumenthal from Connecticut, who's a Democrat, and it was sponsored by the two Democrat senators from Massachusetts and the two Republican senators from Florida. So if you have Scott and Warren in the same bill, that says something about it. So if you haven't so done yet, I urge you to contact your representative and senators, either to thank them if they're already signed on to the bill or to ask them to support it so that it can be passed by easily. Again, these are bills in support of the Arecibo Observatory, its contributions to science, and it encourages the NSF to look for ways to look for, get funding to build instruments that can replace the scientific instruments that were lost and scientific capabilities that were lost with the collapse. I will leave that. I see someone with Marshall. I see you have your hand up, but let's be quick because you know we want to start with.
Yeah, I was just asking. Can you post the resolution numbers?
Oh yeah, chat? Yes, yeah. Sorry, I actually was looking for that before I have it here. So here's the press release from the House, or from the office of Jennifer Gonzalez, and here's the press release from the office of Senator Blumenthal. I believe both have links to the, yeah, to the bill. I think they're both the same, but I haven't looked, I haven't checked. Okay, good. So now for the main attraction of today, we'll have Luca Olmi from the Observatorio Fisico di Arcetri, giving us a talk on, I forgot the title, sorry. You can say it, but I'll let me introduce you to Luca. He's been working on radio telescopes for a while now. He got his PhD from Università di Firenze back in 1992. And since then, afterwards, he worked at Arecibo, at the Arecibo Observatory, as a research associate until 1996. Then at the University of Massachusetts in Amherst, where he was a senior research associate working in the astronomy department with the LMT, or the Large Millimeter Telescope Project. He's been working also with the BLAST collaboration, and BLAST stands for the Balloon Airborne
Something. Large Aperture. Don't worry.
Large Aperture Some Millimeter Telescope?
Yes.
And he's worked also with SRT, the Sardinia radio telescope, not to be confused with the small radio telescope. So he has a vast experience with radio telescopes. And today he will talk to us about
Luca. Reflectarrays.
Yes. So take it away.
All right. Yes. So thanks, Hector, for your introduction. Let me share the screen. So can you see it?
Yes.
Yeah.
All right. Sorry. Let me go back. Okay. So hello, everybody. I will be talking today about reflectarrays, and I will give you broad review of this technology, and more importantly, I will try to convince you that reflectarrays are worth further investigation because they have a number of interesting features, not only for potential applications for the new Arecibo telescope, but also for radio astronomy in general. Now, let me tell you beforehand that I'm not an expert on the reflectorrays. I don't really have a working knowledge. I encountered this technology several years ago during the preparation of a funding proposal. Those who were experts on this technology were actually several other colleagues. However, it was a good experience because I learned a few things about reflectorrays, and that's why I believe that they have a really potential interest for our community. So after a brief introduction, I will describe the basic functioning of a reflectorray, and then I will describe and we'll discuss some limitations and interesting features of reflectorrays, which are of particular interest to radio astronomical applications. For example, multi-band and active reflectorrays, and also more complex optical configurations, such as dual reflector and non-parabolic configurations. And then in the last part of my talk, I will give you some ideas that might be of interest for the next Arecibo facility. But first, please let me do some publicity to my home institute. The Arcetri Astrophysical Observatory in Florence is part of the Italian National Institute for Astrophysics that operates the three major radio telescopes in Italy, the two sister antennas with a 32 meters diameter in Sicily and in Medicina near Bologna, and then the larger 64 meters antenna, the Sardinia Radio Telescope, which is, of course, placed in the island of Sardinia, and which is going right now a major instrumentation upgrade. And our radio astronomy group in Arcetri is quite small, but however, we have a significant expertise in several areas, and they were also involved in a number of important projects, such as ALMA, SKA, and of course, the Sardinia Radio Telescope. So now let's take a look at what the main type of high gain antennas are. And as you know, of course, there is the reflector antennas, and then there are the two type of reflector arrays, which are the phased arrays and the reflector arrays. So the major difference between the reflector antennas and the arrays is generally the fact that reflector antennas are much bulkier, higher mass, and therefore has a more complex mechanical structure. And in the end, this may mean that they are even more expensive. On the other hand, the arrays have some limitations which are characteristics of arrays only, and typically they are bandwidth limited. There are also some major differences between phased array and reflector arrays, which we're going to discuss in the next couple of minutes. But basically, the phased arrays usually have a more complex hardware and therefore are generally more lossy and expensive, whereas the reflector arrays are generally simpler in terms of design and construction, therefore also cheaper. As an example of the working of a phased array, you can see here, let me see if I've managed to get rid of this. Okay, so a phased array is basically an array of antenna elements. These elements can be, for example, dipole, feed horns, et cetera. And this array of antennas is fed by a complex beamformer module, which include a number of electronic components such as phase shifters, amplifiers, switches, and et cetera. And therefore, this is the beamformer module. It's quite a complex system. And the phase shifters in particular are those that control the phase delay to each antenna so that the resulting outgoing wavefront can be steered in a given direction, as you can be seen in this cartoon. So the main point here is that this array of antenna needs a complex beam-forming network to work. And as an example, I put here a picture from the US WAVE POSE. This is a phased array warning system. It's a military radar for early ballistic missile defense, and it's located in Cape Cod, Massachusetts. And on the right panel, you can see the single elements that compose these array, which are cross dipoles. So now let's take a look at the basic structure of a reflector array. A reflector array, contrary to a phased array, is an array of unit cells or patches, which are illuminated by single feed horn. So in this case, the feeding of the elements of the array is spatial, as it's not through a complex beam-forming network. And the phase shift is applied to each unit cell more or less in the same way in order to shape and steer the beam direction. And in this case, we can see that the spherical wave emitted by the feed incident on the reflector ray has to be transformed into a reflected planar wavefront. And this can be achieved by adjusting each element of the reflector ray so that it has the correct phase shift. And usually this phase shift can be achieved by varying a single element of each unit cell, as we're gonna see in a few minutes. And here's a picture of a typical reflector ray. In this case, it's an off-axis reflector ray. And there is in the inset on the top right, you can see the individual unit cell, which in this case are split square loops. And the basic principle here is that by changing the shape and composition of the unit cell, you change its complex impedance, which in turn change the phase shift, which is applied to the reflected wavefront. Now, it's of interest to take a look in more detail of how this phase shift takes place, because it helps us to understand the main limitation of a reflector ray. And here you can see a picture of the working of reflector ray in transmission, but of course the same would be in receiving mode. Here you can see a feed horn, which is radiating a spherical wavefront on the reflector ray surface. And what we want from the reflector ray is that this spherical wavefront is converted into a planar wavefront. In order to do this, we need the reflector ray to provide an overall phase distribution. And the phase distribution is such that each element of the reflector ray must compensate for this phase shift, which is also a differential spatial delay, which is indicated here as delta S. And this optical path delay is simply the difference of the optical path from the feed to any element of the reflector ray minus the same optical path from the feed to the central element. And in the reflector ray literature, this is usually indicated as a multiple of the wavelength. N is an integer, and D is actually a fractional number between 0 and 1. So this delta S is different at each position, and we must basically design each unit cell in the reflector array to give the appropriate phase shift as a function of position. And this can be done using different techniques. You can for example, you can have the same shape for the unit cell, a square in this case, for example, but you can change the size and this will give you a different phase shift, or you can have exactly the same shape, but you can rotate it. This will also give a different phase shift, or you can use phase and time delay lines. Here is a specific example. This is a unit cell. This unit cell is basically cross dipole with length L. And on the bottom right, you can see the phase response of this unit cell with as a function of the length. And so the phase response is different as a function of the length. And therefore, what you have to do is to design each unit cell on the surface of the reflector ray so that its length is the necessary one to provide the correct phase shift. Now, this is all nice and very interesting, but it works, of course, only for a very a specific case, which is at a specific frequency and for a given beam direction. For example, if you change the frequency around the central frequency or the wavelength, it's the same, of course, then the phase shift that needs to be applied to each element is going to be different. And in this case, for example, if you have a shift in wavelength delta lambda, then the differential spatial delay to be applied is this integer multiple of lambda plus delta lambda. And therefore you get a phase error in the sense that each element, if you have designed each element of the reflector ray to be working at the central wavelength, then as you move to a different wavelength, it is no longer working properly. So in other words, if you're working at the central frequency, the spherical wavefront incident on the reflector ray from the feed horn will be correctly converted into a planar wavefront. On the other hand, if you're working at a different frequency or wavelength, then every unit cell on the reflector ray will not provide any longer the correct phase shift, and therefore your wavefront, your reflected wavefront will be distorted, and so will be your beam in the far field. This is also known as beam squint, and is a problem that takes place in all type of arrays, basically. So what are the possible solutions to minimize this effect? There are basically two different approaches. One is a geometrical or optical approach, and you can see it here. If you, for example, you use an antenna optical configuration with a higher F number, then your spherical wavefront on the reflector ray will be less curved, as you can see from the blue line wavefront here. This, of course, has the consequence that the differential spatial delay is smaller at each position on the reflector ray. And this basically have the equivalent effect of decreasing this integer number n. And therefore, this reduces is a technique that can be used to reduce the frequency excursion error. But of course, it needs to have a somewhat longer optical system. And the other solution is to operate at the unit cell level. And if you can design your unit cell so that the phase response of the unit cell is a change, is a function of frequency, then you can solve this problem. And here I have written the spatial delay as a function of both the time delay and also of the phase delay over frequency. So from this simple formula, you can see that if you want your spatial delay or time delay to be the same over a bandwidth, over a range of frequencies, you have to have the phase shift to change linearly with frequency as well. And this is the technique that is currently mostly used with reflector arrays using true time delay lines, which can provide the same and correct delay in a range of frequencies up to several 360 degrees phase cycles. This is again a plot that shows the phase shift of the individual unit cell as a function, for example, of the line length in a cross dipole. And there are several lines, each one for a different frequency from 9 to about 11.6 gigahertz. And what you really want in this plot is that the different lines for different frequencies must be more or less parallel to each other, so that when the frequencies change, the phase offset is more or less the same at different line lengths. And this ensures that in each position on the reflector array, the spatial differential delay is the same, approximately the same, even if the frequency is changed in a range. So to summarize, you can improve the bandwidth of reflector arrays by using either this specific unit cell design. There are, of course, other passive designs for this unit cell, which I'm not going to discuss, which can give fractional bandwidth up to 20% or even higher. And the optical design approach is basically to use a higher F number. Also, you can use this solution as shown in this picture, where you can use a curved reflector with piecewise flat surfaces, which approximate a parabolic surface. And therefore, these allow you to basically, at the same time, extend the bandwidth of your reflector array and also increase the ability to scan the beam in a given direction, as we will see in a few minutes. And this table is just to give you an idea of what are the fractional bandwidths that can be achieved with different design of the unit cells. And basically, you can see that these numbers goes from a few percent to almost a 20% fractional bandwidth. So now I would like to talk a little bit about the application of reflector arrays as multi-band devices. And there are two major groups in this class. There are those who are designed to work at largely separated frequency bands, which is the rather astronomical case. And the other group is those who are designed to work in closely separated frequencies, which are typically used for satellite communication. But the rule of thumb is the same. And if you want to have different wavebands, then you're going to require different type of unit cell. As an example, in this slide, you can see two layers dual band reflector array in X and Ka band, which consists of two layers, each one for a separate wave band. And basically, each layer performs as a reflector array at a given frequency, and it's basically transparent at the other frequency. So in this case, the X-band array, which is on the top layer, is basically transparent in Ka band. And you can make this type of reflector arrays cheaper and easier to fabricate is if your unit cell can be tuned by using a single regulating parameter. This is yet another example. In this case, it's a single layer, three-band reflector array, where all the different unit cells for the different wavelengths are have been designed to be on the same layer. And you can see that here you go from Ka band to C band and X band. And in every single waveband, you have a unit cell with different geometry. It goes from a circular ring in Ka band to split square loop in X band. And then in order to change the phase shift in each individual band, you also use a different technique. In Ka band, you use the rotation of the unit cell, whereas, for example, in C band, you can adjust the size of the element. So as you can see, there are techniques, and more techniques are being developed every year in order for reflector arrays to be able to work at different wavelengths. In this specific case, I wanted to give you an idea of what are the refractional bandwidths that can be achieved. This is an example from the same slide as before. This is from several years ago already. And you can see that the fractional bandwidth in this case was not great. It was between roughly 2% and about 6%. Now, the other interesting feature of multi-band reflector arrays is that not only you are able to observe the same source in different wavelengths, but if you want, if you choose to do so, you can observe different sources at different wavelengths. This is an interesting and attractive feature for radio astronomical applications, of course. And this is something that, for example, with your classical parabolic reflector, you cannot do. Now, let's introduce the so-called reconfigurable reflector arrays. They are a different class from what we have seen so far, the fixed reflector arrays. The fixed or passive reflector arrays are those who basically emulate their reflector antenna counterpart, but in which the beam direction is fixed. So you design your unit cell and you assign the phase shift to each unit cell on the reflector array so that the beam is steered in a single direction. The phase response of the single cell is not tunable, and therefore the beam direction cannot be changed. At least it cannot be changed electronically, but you will have to move the whole reflector array. However, in the so-called reconfigurable reflector arrays or active reflector arrays, the beam can be dynamically controlled. And this can be done by introducing at the level of the unit cell some controllable mechanism that allow to change the phase shift properties. And for example, here you can see how the simple cross dipole that we have seen before can be changed to include several other electronic components that basically allow to change the phase response of the unit cell. In this specific case, this cross dipole has been modified to be able to change its capacitance, and by changing the capacitance of the unit cell, then you can change its phase response. And the interesting thing is that this phase response can be controlled electronically, and so you achieve the ability to control the direction of your beam fully electronically. So the electronically driven phase tuning are the most interesting among reflector arrays. They are clearly the most interesting in communication and radar application because they provide the highest scan speed, but they also are of interest for radioastronomical application. And as we have seen in the example before, you can change the phase tuning by using lumped elements, but there are also technology that allow to use tunable dielectric materials where you can polarize the dielectric material at different levels, and therefore you change its impedance and the phase shift response. Of course, this has a cost because the design of the unit cell is much more complicated. And here is just an example of on the left in this picture, you have on the left the simple design of the unit cell in the case of a fixed beam reflector array, and on the right panel, how this unit cell needs to be modified in order for the phase to be able to be electronically tuned. So of course you get this ability to scan the beam electronically, but the cost is in the more complex design of the unit cell. And as far as I'm concerned, in reading the current literature, I haven't really been able to find examples where the beam could be scanned more than about plus or minus 10 beams in any direction. And so the beam scanning range is limited, but of course there are techniques that allow it to be expanded. The other limitation of the reconfigurable reflector arrays is their bandwidth, because they have to basically achieve a trade-off between the beam scanning and the bandwidth in frequency. Therefore, this trade-off required basically the bandwidth, the fractional bandwidth may be somewhat smaller than compared to the case of the fixed reflector arrays. In fact, here you can see that the fractional bandwidth can vary between roughly 1% to a maximum of 7%. I have to say that this is also an area where, of course, lots of progress has been done as we speak. And then also the dual reflector non-parabolic configurations may be of interest to for radioastronomical application, because they combine the broadband capabilities of the standard parabolic reflector with the simplicity and a cheap cost of the reflector array. So in dual reflector, where you usually have a main paraboloid and a hyperboloidal subreflector, you can decide, for example, to replace one of the two reflectors or even both reflectors with a reflector array. If you replace just the subreflector as in this drawing, then you say that this is a subreflector array. And the main advantage is usually in reducing the antenna volume and mass, which in turn means that you're reducing the mechanical complexity of your antenna, which of course becomes much more cost effective. And then you're also introducing the several other interesting features such as beam scanning and shaping. You can compensate for cross polarization if this is a requirement. And another very interesting feature, you can compensate for surface errors in a very easy way. And this is an example of such an application. This is a 35.5 meters spherical reflector which is using a 30 centimeter diameter subreflector array to compensate for the spherical aberration. And you can see from the figure on the right panel that the subreflector array is positioned within the caustic surface, which allows to make it relatively small. And if you can improve somewhat the compensation of the spherical aberration by making the subgraphite larger, but the improvement is really minor. And I have to say that if you wanted to use a Gregorian corrector to compensate for the spherical aberration, then you have to place it after and outside the caustic surface. And therefore, this makes this Gregorian corrector larger or much larger than the subreflectarray. And that's what makes this technique very, very attractive. And another interesting possibility is to design reflectarrays with non-parabolic phase distribution. What is that supposed to mean? So far, what I have shown to you is basically a reflectarray which receives, for example, an incident planar wavefront, converts it to a spherical wavefront converging to a feed horn. And this is exactly what a parabolic reflector does. So we call this a parabolic phase distribution or transformation. But of course, the other reflectarrays give the possibility to operate on phase as requested. And so, for example, you can also design a reflectarray antenna that emulates a spherical surface, where different portions of the reflector are being illuminated to collimate the beam in a given direction and compensate for spherical aberration at the same time. And the reason for designing a spherical phase reflectarray is mainly because these are ideal candidates for wide angle scanning. In fact, as we have seen before, the parabolic, the equivalent parabolic surface of reflectarrays, it's not great in terms of wide of angle scanning. Therefore, the spherical surface reflectarrays are better candidates. But of course, you have the disadvantage then you have to have the ability to move your feed antenna in order to illuminate different parts of the reflectarrays. And finally, let's see how these features of reflectarray can have some interesting applications specifically for the next facility in Arecibo. And I will start with the case of a single reflector. We know that our community is currently split among those in support of a single reflector and the community in support of a of an array of antennas. So we'll try to give some ideas in both cases. And for the single reflector antenna, the main interesting application of reflectarrays is the one that I just discussed. It's in actually having a sub-reflectarray as the compensator for the spherical aberration rather than having a Gregorian corrector. As I said before, this actually make your subreflectarray much much smaller than the Gregorian corrector, which of course makes it planar, lightweight, and therefore the whole structure supporting this subreflectarray will have to be less complex and less expensive. The other very interesting and attracting feature for radio astronomical application is the fact that you can do your source mapping electronically for small areas. In fact, you can use the beam scanning ability of the reflectarray to scan your beam electronically on the sky. Now, if you remember how inefficient was to do mapping with the old legacy instrument, then you may appreciate how interesting and attractive is this feature if you really are going for a single large spherical reflector. And of course, the bandwidth and multiband capability will need to have to be carefully analyzed. Now, switching to the case of the array of antennas, and I mean either the array of individually steerable antennas or antennas on a movable platform, as it has been suggested in the document on the new generation receiver telescope. Even in this case, you can hypothesize to replace the antenna with an antenna that, for example, has either a subreflector ray replacing a subreflector, or maybe an antenna which is composed by both a subreflector ray and the primary reflector ray. In either case, this allows you to achieve a very low profile, low weight antenna. The whole mechanical system will have to be much simpler and of course less expensive. And then of course you have the same advantage that I mentioned for the case of the single reflector. Now, even in this case, and particularly for the case of the antennas on a moving platform, having the ability to do electronically, to do the source mapping electronically, it means that you don't have to move the entire platform for tracking and mapping the source. So even in this case, the electronical beam scan is a huge advantage. Now, this is probably the most extreme idea that I have for today, in which basically you have an array of fixed planar reflector ray antennas on the ground. Of course, the main attraction of this ideal design is that you have absolutely no moving mechanical part. It's absolutely simple, easy to fabricate, and cheap. The only thing that you need to have is these fixed reflector rays on the ground. And if you're gonna use the off-axis configuration, you need this column to support the feed or the feeds. And your beam tracking and scanning can be done electronically. Now, of course, we all know that this beam, the scanning angle is limited. We already know that, and therefore, eventually, we will have to be able to expand this beam scanning ability if we really don't want to have any mechanical part. Applications to this case are mean that you're not necessarily limited to having this off-axis configuration where the feeds are located at the top of this high column. You can also have a Cassegrain configuration with the feed, which is more conveniently located. For example, you can use either a center-fed Cassegrain configuration, as is shown here on the bottom, and there is already a constructed version which employs both a primary and subreflector reflector rays. Or you can also use, for example, an offset-fed Cassegrain configuration where the feed horn is located at some lower position and outside the main reflector ray. And what I also tried to do in this specific case, which was also the most extreme in terms of construction simplicity, I tried to take a look at what are the trade-off in terms of height of the column, focal ratio, and diameter of the antenna. And I used as constraints these two numbers. I wanted this column to be lower than 25 meters so that it's relatively easy to construct and cheap. And also I wanted to have an F number larger than 0.6. And here are the results. And on the left panel is if you limit your reflector ray to work within one 360 degree cycle for the phase, and on the right panel, if you work, for example, in three 360 degree cycles, which allow to expand the diameter of the individual antenna. And the different colors are for different frequencies from 1 gigahertz to about 20 gigahertz. And then you can see that the diameter of the antennas must vary depending on the frequency. If you're gonna use this technology to work at different wavelengths, then it is the higher frequency waveband that will limit, that will set the maximum diameter of the antenna. And in this case, for example, we can see that if we intend to work up to a maximum frequency of 20 gigahertz, the maximum diameter that we can achieve for the antenna from the figure on the right is about 4 meters. Which means, of course, that then you will need a lot of these reflectarrays on the ground in order to cover your fixed total area. There are a number of options to this design that can be added in order to be able to increase the beam scanning range. And for example, you can use piecewise flat reflectors. You can use either the 1D configuration or the 2D configurations. In the case of the 1D configuration, then of course it means that you will need to be able to move, to rotate these antenna in order to be able to point at different parts of the sky, but only in azimuth. And then you can also build these piecewise antennas using a 2D configuration. And these are existing designs, and at this level, they're just ideas for this possible array, which consists of fixed reflector rays on the ground. So a quick comparison between the fixed the array of fixed antenna or fixed reflector rays on the ground and the array of individual antennas, either steerable or on a platform. So the main advantage in using reflector rays on the ground is, of course, that you have no complex mechanical structure, which makes it extremely simple to build. Cheap, you can have the maintenance is extremely easy. The also other interesting feature is if at some point you want to upgrade it, all you need to do is to eventually replace the reflector rays, which supposedly will become cheaper and cheaper in the future to build. This is, of course, a configuration that is hurricane proof. Even if you have a relatively high column, this is a mechanical structure which is easily to be designed so that it can withstand strong winds. And then, of course, I mentioned the low cost is a very attractive feature. There are a number of limitations, as we have seen, bandwidth is one of them. If you're going to use the reflector rays for different frequency bands, then the design, of course, is going to be more complex and also more expensive. At some point, depending on the optical configuration, you have to consider that you may have some degree of cross-polarization. As I said, the angle range in which you are able to scan your beam is limited, but it can be expanded using the techniques of the piecewise antennas. And the trade-off between the size of the antenna and the other parameters has to be carefully considered if you don't want to have too many receivers. in this sense, having uncooled or ultra-wideband receivers, of course, would be a huge advantage. And then, of course, I haven't talked about radar applications, but that's another application that one need to have to be carefully studied. And so my summary is the following. The microstrip reflectarrays are clearly a mature technology, and they are currently largely diffused in many applications, such as communications and radar, and not yet in radio astronomy. They are much simpler, and they are much lower power consumption compared to their cousin, the phased arrays. They are easy, inexpensive to fabricate in large numbers. And they have a number of interesting features for specific radioastronomical applications. Of course, the current limitations that they may have in terms of bandwidth and others, such as application in multi-band bandwidth and the miscoming, will have to be carefully considered before any decision is going to be made. And this is all I have to say for today.
Thank you very much, Luca. Are there any questions, either through text? Oh, there's some. Okay, well, here are some questions that are trickling in. Can the other cells of reflector array be operated if there is a fault in one or few cells?
That's a good question, and I'm afraid I don't have a specific answer to that. I believe that what it can be done is that reflector arrays can be built, and they have been built using a modular design, where a large area can be built using smaller patches, and therefore if you get a problem in one of the sub arrays, you can replace it. You don't really need to replace the individual unit cell because they're so cheap that it's more convenient to replace a subsection of the entire reflector array.
Another question from the chat is what is the largest existing telescope that uses reflectarrays, and at what range of frequency does it work? Also, are there any existing radar facilities that use reflectarrays?
Yeah, there are many such cases in the literature. What I have seen is mostly application for satellite communications. I'm pretty sure that there are radar applications out there. I don't have the reference at the top of my head. And as far as the largest, I believe that there is a deployable reflectarray that has been built by NASA that has a diameter of about, I believe, 7 meters.
Okay, but by
and it's I believe it was in it was either in X or K band.
By saying that they're in the literature, do you mean that they were actually built or proposed or?
No, this NASA reflectarray has been built. I don't know if it has already been deployed. It was supposed to be deployed on a satellite, and that's another interesting feature of reflectarray. They can be folded in one way or another. They can be sent to space because they're so lightweight, and that's also the technique that you can use to make them in larger area. You can use this modular construction possibility.
Okay, Anish, you have your hand raised. You want to unmute and ask your question?
Luca, what is the percentage of a reflection from each of these cells that is a incident to reflected ratio, reflected to incident ratio?
I'm sorry, what is the ratio?
Ratio of the reflected energy to the incident energy in each of those cells.
No, I don't have that specific number. What I can tell you is that I have seen a comparison between reflector rays and their parabolic reflector counterpart, which means having the same optical configuration, the same diameter. And they have shown that the reflector ray basically had the same antenna gain. So in other words, they basically are equivalent to a parabolic reflector in terms of losses.
Okay, thank you.
You're welcome.
Okay, good. We have more questions in the chat. This one says, could a sub-reflector ray approach handle high power density required for planetary radar purposes?
Yeah, that's one of the questions that I have in my comparison. I show it in red because the radar I haven't really found in the literature any specific paper regarding the energy density in radar application. That, of course, for commercial radar application, that I suppose it's not a problem, but when you talk about the planetary radar, that may be an issue. And that's why in my final list, I wrote the radar application is something in which we need to take a careful look. I don't have an answer to that.
And a follow-up from the same person, Chris Halter. How about polarization performance?
Polarization performance are typically comparable to those of their parabolic reflector counterparts, except as far as I have found in some of the literature, the off-axis configuration may have some cross-polarization issues, as I mentioned at the end of my talk, and that's why the possibility of using a sub-reflector ray is attractive, because if you include the sub-reflector ray in your optical configuration, even if you use an off-axis configuration, you can include a compensation for the cross-polarization, for the extra cross-polarization. So that's something that can be, and it has been compensated.
Okay. And a follow-up to the first question, without replacing the faulty cells, can we operate it instantly by removing those cells by software control?
I believe so, because every cell is basically electronically controlled. And I believe that you can command this cell to give a phase shift that in no way is going to affect the resulting outgoing wavefront.
Okay. Another question. What about the system temperature? Isn't the feed partially seeing the ground through the reflector array?
Yes, it is. And that's something that I haven't discussed. That's part of the fine print in the presentation. Well, of course, you have the same problem as if you were illuminating a parabolic reflector. Of course, you have spillover illumination and aperture efficiency that you have to consider. For the reflector ray, there is no difference. And of course, the maximum diameter that you may use also depends not just from this geometrical consideration that I had used in this simple-minded exercise that I did myself. It has to be done using the aperture efficiencies as the main criterion to determine the maximum diameter that you can use. And therefore, yes, you have to be concerned about spillover, especially if you are using the off-axis configuration with the feed mounted on a pole. If you use the cast grain configuration, of course, your spillover will look at the sky, and therefore this problem is of less concern.
Good. So there's a comment in the chat. instead by Dale Ferguson, who says reflectarrays would be more applicable to narrow bandwidth applications like radar rather than broadband radio astronomy, in my humble opinion, he mentions.
Yeah, that's what is the public feeling, the common feeling about reflectarrays is exactly that. And I believe that that's the reason why they haven't been used yet for radio astronomical application. However, there is a rapid progress that is being done on reflectarrays, and there is a huge effort in trying to increase their fractional bandwidth, as well as trying to improve their multi-band capabilities. And I believe that in the next few years, these capabilities will be absolutely expanded, because they are basically demanded by the users.
Okay, that's good. One question came in. Are all reflectarray geometries square grid based? What about hexagonal?
No, they basically can have, I have seen all different type of shapes. And of course, the different type of the shape can also depends on the required application. And therefore, the different shape also require an appropriate illumination by the field. So basically, the type of the reflectarray is really depending on the application. For example, if you use there are reflectarrays that are being used for beam shaping and to illuminate certain geographical areas on the surface of the Earth, and therefore they have a very funny shapes.
Okay, good. I think that was the last question that came in. Any other questions for Luca? Well, for not being an expert, I think you did a very good job, Luca.
Thank you, Hector, and thanks everybody.
At least to me, I didn't know much about them.
So no, I hope that this can trigger some interesting discussion within our community.
Yeah. Well, thank you for joining. This one more of the launch series of talks on radio astronomy and instruments at Arecibo Observatory and other things related to Arecibo Observatory. There will be more. I just don't have the schedule in front of me, but just keep a lookout from emails from ASAP, and we'll let you know more about them. Well, thank you very much, and have a good day.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Thanks, Luca.
Bye.
Bye. Bye.